Hi. So I'm going to come clean, like, right up front with you all, just so that no awkward conversations happen later. It's Australian, the accent, because sometimes, not New Zealander, not British, Australian, which means I speak really fast when I get excited. So I'm sorry if I say things you can't understand because all the words run together. And the other thing I have to come up front with is that I'm actually not a graphic designer. I studied product design, and mainly because when I was trying to choose my career path, I thought that toothbrushes were really interesting. I know. And I was like, who designs them? I'm going to do that. And also I found remote controls the most stupidly designed things in the world, and I really felt that it was my life duty to participate in making them more functional, aesthetic, and, well, frankly, not as shit as they are. So I actually have never designed a toothbrush or a remote control to this day, so if there's anybody out there who wants to get me to do that, it would fulfill one of my childhood ambitions, which is sad. Anyway, what I do is I work in sustainability, and I am the annoying person who will tell you things about sustainability that makes you feel bad and feel good as well. And so hopefully I can take you on a little journey into my world of sustainability and design. And I want to start with asking you all to do a little mind experiment of quick association. I'm going to put three words up on the screen, and I want you to think, to say out loud to the person next to you the first thing that comes into your mind. Please, please participate with me. I came all the way from Australia. Okay? All right, here are the three words. What's the first thing? What? Someone yell one out for me. Recycle. I heard a lot of recycled, and tree hugger. Great. Awesome. So basically, this world of green eco-sustainability stuff is filled with these preconceived ideas, these frames of what it means to be green and care about the planet. And you know, we have these ideas that, I knew this clicker thing wouldn't work. Yes. Okay. We have these ideas about what it means, nature, biodegradable, recyclable. We have all of the color palette of green and browns and everything else that nature has provided us to. So when we're working in sustainability, a lot of the time we go for the recycled packaging, the green hues, the fluffy animals. We basically perpetuate this idea that sustainability is some niche little thing over here that only crazy people who hug trees do things. Which is really funny, actually, because having worked in sustainability for a long time now, obviously not that long because I'm not that old, long enough to know better, this is not what I do, just for the record. People actually like have this opinion that I hug trees. Thank you very much. It would ruin my silk shirt, okay? And I'm scared of spiders. They could like come at me. So no tree hugging has happened in the last 12 years that I've been working in sustainability, thank you very much. And most people who do sustainability, who hug trees, are just weird. I'm sorry to those people out there who do that, but it is a bit weird, okay? Just leave the trees alone. See, when I was in design school, I learned this absolutely incredible thing. It caused me to have one of many existential crises, and that is that everything in nature is interconnected. I literally was sitting in an engineering class, and the teacher says, oh, so guys, guess what? Everything in nature is interconnected. Anyway, moving right along. And I was like, what? What do you mean everything's interconnected? And I spent the next decade of my life trying to figure out this whole idea of complex systems and how we as individuals and more importantly as designers influence or affect these complex systems. And to break it down to you, basically the world is made up of three main systems. The first is us, human systems, of how we communicate, our words, our language, our ability to interrelate or not interrelate, which is quite common as well. And then we have the industrial systems of all of the things that we create. It's basically the economy. And then all of that stuff, you, me, and the mobile phones in the world, all operate within the biggest and arguably most important system, which is the ecosystem. And there is this misconception out there that somehow the things that fill our lives are disconnected from nature. But absolutely everything ever produced that you have anything to do with, including yourselves, comes from nature. Thank you very much, nature. You're fantastic. You provide everything. Amazing. We are not alchemists. It is not possible for us to make something from nothing. Although I did find out recently that Newton thought that he could make gold from nothing, which is kind of funny, given he gave us the theory of relativity. It's like, yeah, he was going for both avenues, you know. Anyway, and this is one of the most important things I think I've ever learned, apart from everything in nature's interconnected, is that everything comes from nature at some point, and therefore we have this, like, inherent reliance on the planet for survival. Just saying. It's a pretty basic concept. I think we forget it quite a bit. And that the thing is that when we go to talk about the things that fill our lives, I think we forget about the story. And we can all tell our own life stories. And apparently, according to this infographic, we're all going to end up in wheelchairs, which says something about how buildings are designed. Just saying. But so can everything that we create. And given my early product fetishes with toothbrushes and mobile phones and remote controls, I decided to basically become a professional product life deconstructor storyteller, something to that effect. And I am fascinated by this idea of what's called life cycle assessment, which is a scientific process of investigating the whole of life implications of a product, service, or system, basically. And basically, the broken down version is that the life stories of everything else that's created in the world is pretty simple. There's five stages to start with. Everything comes from nature. We've all got that one now. And then we take all of these extracted materials and we manufacture them into widgets and things. And then we package and transport and send them all over the world. And then you and I come in and we plug things in and we use things. And then, of course, there's end of life, where we throw stuff out or we recycle it. This is pretty basic, right? That's what everything that exists in the world goes through, in a very basic sense. And us humans are amazing because we are absolutely fixated on only one end of that spectrum. It's like we're all death obsessed, except for we're not, we're just looking at waste. It's like if we spent our entire lives going, oh, I think I'm gonna die today. All we think about when it comes to sustainability is waste. And I understand this because we generate it ourselves. We have to carry those bags from our homes to the bins. We see litter on the side of the road and it annoys us. And waste is a major problem, don't get me wrong. But because we're all so focused on waste, we're ignoring everything else. And in ignoring everything else, we're actually creating bigger problems. And I believe that design is one of the critical points of influence and effect to assisting in the world in solving these problems. I know that's really grandiose, but I hopefully will not disempower you with those statements. So everything that's created has a story that can be told. And given my self-appointed title of official product deconstructive storyteller, which I just made up on the spot right now, so if anyone wants to make me a logo for it, that would be great. I really am passionate about communicating this stuff, and really into education, as one inclined in sustainability is, and I teach a lot, and I found this really annoying thing was happening where I get asked to come and do these lectures, and I kind of arrive, and I do my story, and then I leave, and the teachers are like, thanks so much, that was great, I had no idea, and now I don't know what to do, and I feel really despondent, and but thanks anyway, I think the students really got something out of it. I'm just gonna go develop a drinking problem now. So I was like, oh shit, I really gotta do something a bit more enabling here rather than just like come in, do the spandangle thing and leave. And so I developed this animation series called The Secret Life of Things, which is basically an opportunity for me to have an alter ego talking mobile phone. I don't have time to show you the animation, the first one that we did, there's three. This is Eric, his full name is Mr. Eric Sun. And he's having an existential crisis, as one does when they're thrown in a drawer and abandoned for a newer model of phone. And he goes and seeks past life regression therapy. And in his therapy session, we learn all about his life cycle stages and what decisions a designer who was creating him could have done better in order to solve his life problems. So this project has a whole series of educational materials that go with it, and it's being used in universities and high schools all over the world. It's been translated into like 20 languages. It's in three museums. I'm not blowing any trumpets here or anything. It's won a few awards. Anyway, it's talking mobile phone. basically. But what we try and do, what I try and do with my practice in sustainability and design, is try and find new avenues to intervene in the way people do things. I think that we've come so complacent about this whole idea of social and environmental equitable things, and it seems like it's always easier for somebody else to do it. And one of the problems that I've always encountered is that there's a lot of myths that get bandied around, just like the myth that everybody who works in sustainability hugs trees. There's a lot of other myths, and those myths are debilitating. They actually prevent us from being able to solve problems. So I made an app in 2010. I'm pretty sure a lot of you have made apps, right? Who's made apps? Aren't they just the shittest things ever to make? Seriously, they are so complicated. They're not like a website. A website's good, an app is complicated. That was my experience, anyway. But we made this app and it has a whole series of myth-busting things, and I'm gonna run one by you right now. Okay, if the clicker would progress forward, please. Thank you. I found out that there's a guy at the back. When I click this, he pushes a button. It's like analog, digital analog delay. Seriously, it's the secret. Sorry for mentioning it. And I hated it because I was like, I am not in control of my PowerPoint. Shit. Okay, anyway. Okay, so plastic or paper bags. In the supermarket, and you're given a choice between a plastic or a paper bag. Nobody say reusable because we all know that's better, but just say you're given those two options. Which one do you pick if you want to do the right thing? Can I have a show of hands for paper bags, please? And plastic bags? There is a good speckling of you. Interesting. Okay, so this is really common, of course. Paper bags make sense. They're brown, we've all established. That is a criteria for being environmentally friendly. They're made from paper, which is, as we know, recyclable and biodegradable. And so that, it intuitively makes sense that they'd be better. But what we don't think about, perhaps, is, we see something like this in our mind. It makes sense. And bags floating in the water, it's terrible. But we don't think of things like this, which is the environmental implications of production for paper products. We don't think of the chemicals that are used and for the trees that are cut down. And we don't actually have that kind of mental image because we haven't actually been programmed with that mental image, to be completely honest. And so what happens is that we have this assumed idea that paper is better. Now, I explained earlier, I've worked in this thing area called life cycle assessment, and a few years ago, a study was done, and we found out that when you look across the entire life of both products and you take into consideration how many are littered, how many go to landfill, how many get recycled, all of those things, the paper bag is actually worse for the environment. The plastic bag is better. You're like falling asleep on me here, right? Okay, da-da-da-da. Who can tell me why? I know that the people with their hands up know the answer to this. Can someone scream it out? It's obviously trees are a part of it, but it's actually the picture kind of tries to give it away. No, oh, I love how interactive you all are. I wish you had microphones. I can't actually hear if anyone said the right thing, so I'll just say it. The paper bag weighs more. Yes, it's heavier. So a paper bag weighs between 4 to 10 times more than a plastic bag. Now, the most important thing about this is that when you use a bag to carry your groceries home from the supermarket, you're using it for its utility, its functional unit, one would say. And when you compare a kilo of plastic and a kilo of paper, totally the plastic's worse. But you don't use exactly the same amount of material to achieve the functionality. And so what happens is, in order to get your grocery items home, you need more material, and therefore it's an increased environmental impact. And now you're all going, she's so wrong, I don't agree with her. I completely agree with you that these two options are a cake and that we shouldn't be using disposable things to begin with. But remember, we're all focused on end of waste, end of life and recycling, and somehow if it's reusable and recyclable, it absconds us from all of the other environmental impacts that have occurred beforehand. And this is one of the biggest problems that we face, is this misperception and the fact that nobody stops to look at all the plastic stuff that you've put in your bags to carry home. That's a whole other story. Okay, and this is the worst thing though that happens here in the States, is that, so the functional unit of a paper bag is not as effective as the functional unit of a plastic bag, so supermarkets, who I will not name, have a policy of double bagging. right? So it's already bad, and then we're gonna make it like double as bad because they don't carry things in them properly. So we've actually gone and like possibly quadrupled the environmental impact, if you can count. I can't figure out whether that's quadrupled yet, possibly. Anyway, the environmental impact. And I know you're all going, oh, but hang on, I reuse mine, great. Or I recycle it, fantastic. Paper can only be recycled 5 times, just so you know. And you're thinking, yeah, but the bags in the oceans, they're really bad. And I completely agree, the bags in the oceans are really bad. But let me just propose something here. If you did use this type of plastic bag and you took your groceries home and then you used it instead of using one of these bags, is it better? Yeah. Because what happens is the bag, the plastic bags used for normal trash can receptacles. Sorry, I usually say bin because I'm Australian and I know that nobody really uses that, so I had to correct myself mentally. Trash can liners are made from a higher density polyethylene, or low density polyethylene, but it's thicker and therefore it has a bigger environmental impact. So if you actually made the choice to use those bags and made sure they didn't end up in landfill, great. At the end of the day, though, the reason I'm telling you this story is that because we have misdirected our choices. And there's all of these organizations around the planet that are like, ban the bags. Yes, totally ban disposable bags. I think that's a fantastic idea. But make sure the alternative that you put in place is better for the environment. And that is very common for us to end up with these kind of band-aid solutions. And this is what economists call the law of unintended consequences, and it happens to the best of us. It's where our intentions actually create in bigger outputs than we thought. And we'd all know this from when you accidentally have a couple glasses of wine and say that thing to your cousin that you shouldn't have said, that your mum told you, and the next thing you know, there's family feud. That is the law of unintended consequences happening in your family. And it happens when, as designers or as consumers, we make choices and we don't actually see the ramifications, or we don't think through where it's going to end up. And a classic example of this is actually with bags, again, the biodegradable bags that have been put in place, which is their bags made out of like corn cellulose fibers, is that one of the direct results of those policies was that more land that was previously used for growing food was now creating plastic bag alternatives, which meant that more farmers had to go out and find new land, which meant large tracts of the Amazon and other rainforests cleared. So, just saying, unintended consequences often lead to bigger environmental impacts. And so now you're probably all sitting there thinking, oh, she's really confused me. Everything I thought that was true is wrong, and I really don't want to deal with this anymore. I'm just not going to listen to her because her voice is really annoying as well. but let me just tell you, I think sustainability is totally about chess. Bear with me here. Okay, does anyone play chess? Okay, a few nerds in the room, great. Okay, so I love chess, it's fantastic. And I recently discovered this fascinating thing about chess. And when you're starting a game, you have 20 options at the beginning. And then you both take one move, and then your options are increased to 400 after the first move. And then after you've had your second move, what do you think the options are increased to? Take a guess, wild number. Huh? 600, 6,000, 1,200, 72,000, 4 moves. Wait, it gets better, okay? When you've done 3 moves, four, 2 times 2 is 4, Leyla, great. When you've done, when everyone's had their third move, that number increases to like over 9 million. And then after the fourth move, I had to write it on my hand, it's 288 billion choices. But people still play chess. Right? They're not there going, shit, there are so many options, I can't make a choice. People still play chess. So I don't know why people don't do sustainability. It's like, yeah, there are so many options, I don't know what to do. But hey, I have this little board and I have these tools and I can make a difference in what I do. That's my chess analogy. Because the reality is that designers totally influence the world, they influence behaviors. We don't actually ever know the impact that we have by that choice of what font to use, or the color, or the packaging, or any of the choices that we make as designers have these major impacts on the people that they end up filling their lives. Anyway, you get the point. Okay, so I'm running out of time here. So I basically, I would like to call myself a design interventionist. It's just a new term. And we look at trying to find ways in my studio of taking old ideas and making them relevant. And so we developed these design play cards. They're a series of educational tools that take old ideas about sustainability but make them kind of cute and fun and viable for the educational sector. You can download these for free on the internet, or you can get boxes of them from the shop here. But basically what we did was we've taken these challenges and design thinking and problem solving, and we've paired them up. And again, these are being used in universities and education settings all over the world, and we've won a few awards for them too. And just to finish, I'll just say, like, sustainability is totally an opportunity. It's not a problem. I think for far too long people have been going, oh, sustainability means we have to, like, get rid of things or do that, or it's really boring and tree huggery, but it's totally not. I 150,000,000% believe that if you take the sustainability lens and you look at your design problems in that way, you will only ever create more innovative outcomes. And design is basically one of the strongest form of cultural currency that we have. We create things that other people emulate, that they enjoy, that they love, that they hate. And it's part of our world as designers to influence other people's worlds. That's what we do, no matter what kind of design. And the choices that we make today as individuals, and especially as professional practitioners in the design industry, are the legacy that we leave for tomorrow. I think there's two things that you need to do sustainability in design. One is you need to be curious. Curiosity did not kill the cat, I think boredom did. And then you need to take that curiosity and the willingness to ask questions and to wonder why and to look at the nuances and the systems and the relationships and things. You need to take that curiosity and you need to turn it into being courageous. Because we can only make change when people are willing to be courageous. Thank you. We're doing chairs?
Oh. Your choice, or you can sit in both if you like.
I'll just put my alter ego, the mobile phone, there. You can ask him any questions you want.
His
name's Mr. Erickson. The
thing about our paper bags or plastic bags, more environmentally sound across all the cost benefits, I love facts like that because they are facts and because they're counterintuitive versus belief. Oh, yeah. Brown, as you say. How much of the challenge, of the sustainability challenge and getting everybody on board and moving all the various battleships that need to be moved, is a matter of education?
Look, I mean, it's kind of the default to think that if you educate people, that knowledge will somehow result in action. And my sociology brain goes, that doesn't happen, because people, I was going to say people are stupid, but then I realized there's a video camera there. So I don't mean that. People are lovely. But people are also lazy, and they like to skirt and avoid and, you know, are inherently, they're hard to change. We're complex beings, you know. So just because you tell somebody that it's bad for the environment or it's good for the environment doesn't mean that they're going to make your preferable choices. So I believe that what's critical is that you help with the choice editing. So designers, especially in the product world where I work, basically can alleviate the less environmentally beneficial products from the marketplace through innovative thinking and problem solving. And if you provide alternative services, like service-based models, and you provide people with the value that they're going to get, the argument is well-crafted and it appeals to the different nuances and humanity, then we're far more successful, rather than being like, you should care. Care,
right.
care.
Right.
Does that hurt?
No. Do it more.
I get to hit him. This is great. Does anyone have anything against him? I can hit him harder.
And what are service-based models? My jargon alert went
off.
Okay,
so like something
means.
Like you guys have Zipcar here, right? The car model, like Airbnb. These are all service-based models where we're taking assets that have got material, environmental, embodied impacts, and we're taking them and we're increasing their utility. So with the bags example, if you use your paper bag 10 times or something instead of the plastic bag, its utility starts to equal its environmental impact. There's like a sweet point that you can get with anything that's created. But the problem is that we undervalue things, and we actually are quite waste obsessed. Like, we kind of go, oh, well, You know, I can get another one of those. That's easy. Oh, it's so much more convenient for me if I do it this way.
So designing new systems like Zipcar is a kind of workaround, certainly in this country, where we have, at this point, a political culture that is not educable, which is to say we have a lot of climate change deniers and saying it's not even a problem. What do we care about this stuff? So are you saying that systems like that...
So you know how I said before people are stupid? They're the ones I was talking about.
Yeah. Well, but laziness is a bigger problem.
They're also lazy.
Yeah, yeah.
So I see what you're saying. I think that the education argument, it's the same with regulation. It's the stick in the carrot. There are so many fantastic examples of solutions, which obviously if I had another 20 minutes, I could go into it, but of examples where companies or like change agencies have used kind of softer manipulation techniques. There's the really famous one of the piano stairs. Have you seen that? Where in Google piano stairs, where they basically put, they made a set of stairs, pianos, and then there's the elevator or the escalator, and everybody, of course, chooses to use the stairs. It changes their behavior just through making it fun and engaging. And I personally believe that telling people that the world is going to end if we don't solve climate change is the stupidest marketing tactic of the last 100 years, because basically when you get told something scary that you feel completely disempowered, what are you going to do? Like, you're going to totally turn your back on it.
So make the solutions not only well-designed in a functional sense, but make them beautiful and fun and all
totally.
Those things.
Yeah.
Not only is it a bad marketing campaign, it seems as though you are natively optimistic more than you are pessimistic.
So when we have a whiskey later, you'll find the pessimistic side that lurks there. No, I mean, I think that you have to be, if you're going to be working in this space, you have to be, understand your hypocrisy, be willing to be pessimistic, but ultimately I have to be optimistic because there is so much wonderment in the world. Like, it's amazing. We are so lucky to be alive at this point in time as well. And we take it for granted. And I think that is the laziest thing that we could possibly ever do, is to not stare at the world and think, holy shit, we are so lucky. That was so lame. Yay for me. I feel like I'm on the Oprah couch.
Yeah. And I love Minneapolis, okay? Yeah. One of the great graphic design achievements, branding achievements of between 8 and 15 years ago was the rebranding of BP, British Petroleum, as a green company.
Beyond petroleum.
And a little, beyond petroleum, a little green and yellow flower and all
so
that.
So that's what we call greenwashing. And then what do? They invest all their money in solar panels, and then they slowly de-invest in solar panels.
Which I can't think of a better example in the last few years since Deepwater Horizon and that disaster to make people cynical about the idea that any large businesses, when they say they're being eco-friendly, are being. Do you?
Basically, if they're saying they're being eco-friendly, they're probably not. That's a pretty good rule. Because if you feel like you have to pronounce something so obviously, you've got something to hide. And I think that I'm totally into subversive design, so all you designers out there, don't tell your clients what you're doing, just do it. And the other thing is that sustainability needs to not be a word that has currency anymore, it needs to just be the way we do things. So going around going, look how green I am, how sustainable I am, ultimately perpetuates this framing that it's something external that you can pick to do, rather than a common human necessity to survive on the planet, kind of like stupid if you don't get that, you know? Like air, food, and water, we can't live without them, and we're systematically destroying every single system on the planet that provides us with those things, and Mars is so not gonna happen. There's like 7.5 billion of us.
But for the rich guys, and this is no joke, the rich guys think
they're
it will happen for them.
Yeah.
They talk about extraplanetary futures for a certain fraction of people. Quickly, we're out of time, but I want three, if you could make three wishes, not magical wish, genie wishes, but three wishes to get where you think we need to go in terms of business behavior, government behavior, individual behavior, what are the three wishes?
I am racking my brain and I cannot think. Three.
One is okay.
Yeah. I think that basically the critical thing we need to do is what we need to see. This is so important, and I can't say it enough, that this idea of sustainability is actually an opportunity. It's not a problem. Like this, everybody going around going, oh, it's so hard and painful and boring and ugh, and we have to give up stuff. It's like, of course, if you think that way, why would you ever want to do it unless you're like crazy me? And that's really annoying and exhausting. So it would be really great if more people just flipped the switch in their brain and went, sustainability, yeah, awesome. I'm so going to do something to change the world today.
That sustainability glass is half full. Thank you. Leyla Acaroglu. Thank you.